is, he's not easy to do. 2 Corinthians chapter 13. It's not, not hard to do the same thing. What's hard is to find out if I got a man. My wife is leaving me that way. I pass it on and turn it off in the house of the Lord. And so I have respect for the people. You know, I posted some on Facebook last night that I had posted back in 2011. I said, you won't get good witness for Christ. For Christ, I got 3 ways. Number 1 is be on time. And number 2, you pay your bills. Number 3 is that thank you. And you're welcome. Come on,
Amen.
If you do those things, you'll be a good testimony for Christ.
Yes.
I had somebody come and say, you know, I had a pastor one time that said, if you don't pay your bills, don't tell me you go to my church. You better tell a bad man. And I'm telling you, you know, if you're not a good citizen, you really ain't a good example. Let's move on from that. That's not my message today. My message is found in 2 Corinthians 13:4. And I talk about it a little bit again. So, but before I begin to preach, just a quick reminder that the ladies' luncheon is immediately following the service. We have a great time with the Lord. So you're welcome to stay. We're having communion this morning. And it is an open communion. You don't have to be a member, or you don't have to. You get ready to take communion. And what we will do this morning is we'll serve you. That's the way we begin to do this the first year. We will serve you, Lord. And our leaders will serve you. So stay with that. And just begin to meditate on it and prepare for it. And let God speak to your heart. For he was crucified in weakness, but lives by the power of God. Who said he is? Jesus. For we are also weak in him, but in dealing with you, we will live with him by the power of God. Here's my scripture. Examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. That word examine, you could just say test yourself. Test yourself. Or do you not realize this about yourself, that Christ is in you? So he wants to remind you. Christ is in you. Unless indeed you fail to meet the test. See that right there? He said Christ is in you unless you fail the test. Now we don't believe those type of things, but there it is by the apostle who is teaching. Who says that if you fail the test, Christ may not be in you. And then, but he comes back and says, I hope you will find out that you have not failed the test. Now, here is the message today. God did not make you to fail. God didn't make you to fail. He doesn't want you to fail. And he's done everything in his power to keep you to fail. Now, I remember back in the late 70s, I traveled all the way to Atlanta to take a test to get an FCC license that I was told I needed, which I would have never needed in my career, but I was told I'd go in. And I studied for months to take this test. The thing about those government tests in those days, well, they made them where it was hard for you to pass. And it did not help that I was with a bunch of my buddies. And then all the way up there, we drank beer. And then when we got up there, I had never seen so much dope in all my life. Weed. And I didn't even know where I was at. Had to get up the next morning and go check this test. So that didn't help none. I don't think I smoked any more weed after that. And like how it made me feel. But anyhow, I probably did, you know, I was taking mine. But so I took this test. And it was one of those tests, everybody that's a little older, and so I don't know if you do this anymore. You just circle it with a little pencil filling your name, right? So I took it. The guy who administered the test And so, man, he took that thing, and he had a little template, and he laid the template down over the answer sheet, and I saw all this black. I said, man, I have done good on this day. Then all of a sudden, he shifted and looked at it, and all disappeared. I failed that test. Never did get that license. Now I'm glad I did, because I never did need it. But I failed that test because I believe the government didn't want me to pass the test. I think they made it hard. Now, somebody that was real smart, it wasn't hard, but you know, I wasn't real smart. They just asked a question about vacuum tubes and all this stuff that I would never use. It was, whew. Anyway, so I failed that test. Well, you all are going to be tested in life. We all are. Not just in your business, not just when you're in high school, elementary school, or college, or to get a job, we all need tested. Not just a drug test, or not just any kind of test, but we all going to be tested in life.
Yes.
Now, the surprise that you may have from a preacher this morning is that God will allow you to go through the test. It's hard to believe that God would never do that. I beg you definitely. And I got a scripture to back me up. Because if you go through this life, you're going to be tested. If you're not tested, how are you going to know if you are going to stand? And I'll give you a couple of examples. Number one is found in the Old Testament, the man named Job.
Yeah. Amen.
Now, when I first got saved, when I would read my Bible, I would read that as Job.
Yeah.
I mean, I did that for years. They kept talking about Job. I said, where's Job at? Oh, that's Job. Anyhow, J-O-B, Job. Job was minding his own business. See, man. Doing his own thing. Very successful, had a big family, and loved the Lord. Amen. And served God. Right. And everybody knew he served the Lord. And the Bible says that Satan wanted to test him because of that. Satan wanted to try him. And listen, God said, well, go ahead.
Are you here?
Amen.
Amen.
God said, go ahead and test me. You didn't believe that God would allow it. We did with Job. He said, go and try it out. So Satan did all kind of things against Job. I mean, all kind of stuff. Destroyed all that he had. Killed all of his family, did all of this stuff. And Job would not say that I love God. He would not deny God.
Amen.
Satan said, well, the only reason he ain't doing that is because you got your hand of protection on him. We said, no, I'll let you test him. No, you won't let me make him sick. The Lord said, well, go ahead on. I'm just paraphrasing. The Lord said, go ahead. I take my hand off. See what he does. He won't deny me.
Amen.
Guess what? Satan attacked his body. And finished wiping out everything he had. He had a wife. He didn't wipe her out because Satan was using her to dab him. And to tell him, why don't you just curse God? He didn't have no encouragement. He had nobody on his side. He had some so-called friends that came to him and said, this is your fault, Job. If this, you had to do something. Job said, I ain't done nothing. They said, yeah. I don't want to be a Job friend when I'm my friends. I don't want to be friend like that. If you're in trouble, as a pastor, and I'm going to tell you something, as a pastor, it is my job, it is my duty, it is what God put in me as your pastor, is if I see you doing something, now I'm going to tell you. But I'm not going to tell you what my finger is. I just told you when I was standing for what I did, I didn't take all of it. I am not perfect. And listen, I still mess up. But I love the Lord and I don't want to mess up. Come on, somebody. I don't want to do it. Anyway, so Jesus was like, you sick because you done something. He said, oh, come on now. Come on. You know you need the son. Come on. You know your house burned down. I bet you when in your house, we can find some books or something in there. We can find some DVDs. We can your phone burned up. We can't look at your search history and see what you looked at and what you were doing. Come on now. You know what I mean. Kept on. Don't be a friend like that.
Yeah.
All the sin that comes short of the glory of God.
Yeah.
Why don't you instead come on and get aside from us? I don't know what's happening in your life.
Yeah.
Oh, sometimes it can be what we need.
Yeah.
But sometimes it just takes. But I don't know if it's something we need, maybe that's a case. Come on.
Yeah.
And this left the Lord and said, we're going to do this thing together. We'll walk it out. It'll be all right. Come on, somebody. So anyway, everybody. But finally, God came down and said, now all of his friends are talking, wife are talking, Job are talking, God, come down. This is what God has to do to some of us sometimes. He said, I need you to shut up. Some of us is praying, saying, God, what about this, why is that, and this don't work? I tell you, God may be telling some of y'all, why don't you shut up? I'm trying to talk to you and you won't listen.
That's right.
You're too busy talking. You too busy telling me how it's supposed to be. That's your plan. I got a different plan, but I can't give it to you because you won't close your mouth. And when Job said, when God told him that, when God told him that, he said, I, and he listened. And God went from A to Z about who he was and how what he done. He said, can we do any of that? And Job was restored to the Lord. Now he has a
faith.
And you say, well, Brother Tom, that's in the Old Testament. Yeah, it is in the Old Testament. But I recall a man named Peter who walked with Jesus every day. When they camped out, when they broke bread, when they fried fish, Jimmy, come on.
Hallelujah.
Amen. They eat big, man. They eat husband together. They're doing all this stuff. And he sat at the foot of Jesus and heard everything that Jesus had to say. And I'm telling you, he heard some things that we ain't heard yet. Because John said, if all the sayings and all the deeds of Jesus were recorded, there would not be any books that would contain. Peter was with him every day. And one day, how do you like that? One day, what would you do if you heard the voice of God or if this spoke in your spirit and called you by your name and said, hey, guess what? I'm just gonna give you a test. And you know who I'm gonna let administer the test? Satan. Well, he hates me. I'm already tested. Because he told Peter, he said, now Satan has come to sift you like wheat. If you don't know what that means, that means that to eat good bread, you had to get all the impurities out of the wheat. Because it could be little rocks, little bugs, anything in there.
Yes.
Right? Any unground wheat, and you had to sift it. So when you got through, boy, you could make some concrete. I mean, this is something heavy. But it had to be sifted. Right? That's how he did it. So when he told him that, Peter understood because he'd seen his mama do it. He'd seen his mama make bread. He probably had made bread. He knew that you had to get the stuff out. He said, he has come to sift you like wheat.
Yeah.
And he said to Peter, he said, now you going, before this night's over with, you going to deny me. You say, I've never denied the Lord. This man had walked with him, had talked with him, had heard him, had ate with him. He said, you're going to tell him you don't even know him.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, he's going to do it 3 times before they're wrong. Y'all know this old joke, you've been in church a while. sick. You should have never said, I want him to tell on me. And that happened. But listen to me. I'm dead. I'm crazy. Listen to me. Before he finished speaking and telling people, you know what Peter like, man, I would never do that. You know, I'm going to pass this test, man. I got this. He's just like me. He thought he was ready, but he wasn't ready. Jesus told him, see, I know God had a way to pray. Because with Job, he said, oh, God, what you do? He knows me. He knows me, and he's going to pass his test. And with Peter, he said, son, you're going to pass it. You know why? Because I pray for you. I pray for you. You pray for yourself. You can get in every prayer chain, every prayer lead, every prayer, whatever you want to call it. Get the whole world praying for you. But when Jesus prayed for you, you got somebody praying for you.
Amen.
God did not make you to fail. Are you hearing me? Because he knew that on his own, Peter might fail. But he said, I'm not going to let you fail. I didn't need Jesus.
Amen.
I didn't call on my own.
Yes.
But call on my own, I do all the time. I mess up all the time. But thank God, he has prayed for me. And he is, you know what he said? He said, he left us with this legacy. He said, I am ever interceding for you. Interceding means praying. I am ever praying for you. He's praying for you right now. And when he prays, oh my goodness, everybody stay and looks around. Huh? Because you'll fail the test without.
That's right.
I mean, know that. The apostle said, I pray that you don't fail the test. Because without him, you will. But I'm praying that you will stay close to him so he won't.
Yes.
I'm going to stay close to Jesus.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Hey, why don't you grab somebody and say, let's stick close to him. Let's stick close to him. We're going to be close to him. He used to come, but man, I'm going to be close to Jesus. Because I need to pass the test.
Yes.
And without him, I can do nothing.
That's right.
Woo, without him, I can't do anything. Without him, I will fail. But I'm trusting in Jesus that I'm holding on.
Yes.
That's what the old preacher said. Got to hold on. Hell, hold on. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
That's how it happens now.
Yes, sir.
Hold. I'm going to hold on to Jesus.
Hold on to Jesus.
I'm going to hold on.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, somebody. Hold on. So that you don't fail. See, you didn't fail. You have a test. Everybody told me. I got some friends that sat in here. We talked about this before. Everybody, they said, man, that people tell me all the time. You get to give it to Jesus. It'd be all right. You gave it to Jesus and it went silent. Huh?
Yes.
He didn't say it wouldn't be all right here.
Mm-hmm.
But he said, I'll be with you.
Yes.
He didn't say everything's going to work out like you thought it would work out. But he did say I'd be with you. And he did say I'm praying for you. And I'm still praying for you. So you will go through the test. Peter went through the test and he passed.
Because Jesus prayed for him.
Yes.
Job went through the test and passed. Because he held on to God.
Yes.
And would not deny. So, the Bible says, in 2 Corinthians 11, so that we would not be outwitted by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his design. Huh? Now listen to me. I was thinking about this right before I got up here. And I would have done it back in the day. they shove the test up, you know, so you don't have to know. Because they know people like me back then. They would say they give test number 15 the day I got all the answers. We would have went there. You couldn't go on the line then because there wasn't no line to go on. That's how long ago. But you could have found them somewhere. Somebody saying, hey, I know I got a buddy who got the answer to the test. And for $15, he'll sell it to you. Don't you think I would have done it? I'd have got the money somehow. And I'd have walked, if I could have figured it out, I'd have walked in there. And I would have been like, and then the old standby answer city, if you don't know anything. I did that, y'all, it didn't work. Now, and then I would have passed the test. Don't you think about it? I never would call God a cheat. Huh? Wouldn't call Jesus a cheat. But because I know him, it's almost like I got a cheat sheet. If the answers, I don't know. You know what he said in John chapter 14? Jesus, when he was talking to his disciples, Peter was in that room. He said, when somebody asks you a question, don't worry about the answer. I give it to you. How would you like to have it? It'd be like going in with something in your ear, and there is a question, and just say no. No. It's 15. It's in your ear. And that's what he said he would do. You have no need to answer any matter. I will put the words in your mind.
Yes.
So I don't know what to do. I don't know what direction to take. I don't know which road to travel. He said, don't worry about it. Go left.
Hey, John. Go left.
This is how we do it, everybody. Because I don't care how much I know he's trying to help me pass the test. I'm so stubborn. And Jesus said, go left, go left. And here I go. That's something old man, look at that. I'm like a dog out of a squirrel, right? Oh, that squirrel. Hey,
I'll go left.
Go left! Then I go back. But he's always speaking. You know what? He's speaking to some of y'all this morning.
Yes.
You go in your own way. Mm-hmm. There's a way under man, according to Proverbs, that seems right. But the end is destruction.
That's right.
Lean not on your own understanding.
Yes.
But acknowledge him in all his ways. And he will direct your path.
Yes.
You've been going your own way, saying your own thing, and hey, why don't you just listen to that voice that's giving you that number? It's D, dog, it's D. And I'm saying, no, it looks like A to me. No, that's a trick. Don't be outwitted by Satan, because I know his design and I know his scheme. He wants to trip you up. Come on, somebody. But God did not make you fail. God made you win. God made you an overcomer. God made you more than victorious. God made you to pass the test. He's a present help in the time of testing. He's a present help when no other help is available. He is there with you. Lean into him and pass the test. I'm not going to fail, because Ephesians 2:10 says, we are his workmanship. God made. And God don't make no junk. I done preached this a long time ago. God don't make no junk. Huh? Look at this. I wish you had a mirror right now and say, I ain't junk. Ephesians 2:10 says that we are his workmanship.
Yes.
He's created by us. Created in Christ Jesus for good works to pass the test, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. In other words, I'm saying it to you in plain English. He made you, and he didn't make you to fail. He's got something for you, and you'll make it. Hebrews 10 says, for you have need of endurance. He'll give it to you.
Yes.
So that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one, listen to this, shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in it. So if I walk away from God, I might fail the test. But if I stay close to it, I'm going to pass. Because he said in Hebrews 10:39, but we are not, come on somebody, I am not. I'm not one that shrinks back.
Yes.
And I'm not one that's destroyed. But I'm one who has faith. And that will preserve my soul.
Yes.
Confess that over yourself. Hallelujah to God. Preach that about. You know, back 200 years ago, if you didn't preach 2 hours, people didn't think you preached. If I preached an hour, y'all would be like, I ain't going back there. I'm home. Somebody said, well, you'll be a long minute. I looked at all my messages the other day. On everybody said I'm long minutes. My average length of message is 30 minutes. So now, we stand. We're going to pray again.